decade, your home for Major League Baseball.
The I-70 series continues on ESPN with Carlos Beltran, Johnny Damon, and 18-home run hitter Jermaine Dye. The Royals have already taken one game from St. Louis, who'll be without Mark McGwire. So Jim Edmonds has stepped to the plate to lead the team. He is second in Big Mac with 17 homers and 40 RBIs. In regional action, it's El Duque against Vlad. Next on ESPN, Wednesday Night Baseball. Great to have you with us. Wednesday Night Baseball, Jim Edmonds. 58 games he's played already this year. The only Cardinal to play in every St. Louis game. He is in the lineup against the Royals. And some of you will see Derek Jeter and the Yankees against the Expos. Jeter hitting 500 since returning from the DL. Great to have you with us. John Butchercross here on ESPN's Wednesday Night Baseball. We'll be here throughout the night keeping you up to date on games going on throughout both leagues. And before we do that, let's show some stuff that already happened today. And Sammy Sosa, going deep, his 18th homer of the year. The Cubbies came into the game 11 games under 500, but beat the Diamondbacks 9-4. And Frank Thomas, remember last year, hit just 15 home runs and almost 500 ABs. This year, now has 13 already. How about the White Sox? Most wins in the American League. They beat the Reds 6-4. Griffey Jr. did homer for Cincy. Coming up on ESPN2, 7:30, it's the Blue Jays and the Braves. 7:30 Eastern and 4:30 Pacific time. So once again, we'll be here throughout the night keeping you updated on games going on in baseball. Now it's time for your game. ESPN Wednesday Night Baseball is next.
ESPN's Wednesday Night Baseball is brought to you by Mitsubishi Motors, makers of the new 2001 Eclipse Spider. Wake up and drive. And by Napa. Why do you need genuine Napa replacement parts? Because some things can't be replaced.
I'm Gary Thorne. Join Joe Morgan and me as Jermaine Dye and the Royals take on Jim Edmonds and the Cardinals. It's coming up next from St. Louis. City Royals and the St. Louis Cardinals, the rubber match of this three-game set here in St. Louis tonight. The standings in the American League Central, the Royals are in it, 4.5 games behind the White Sox, the Indians 2 out. For St. Louis, they have moved back ahead of Cincinnati, now in first place in the National League Central, but it is going to be a race. Welcome, everybody. I'm Gary Thorne. For the St. Louis Cardinals, they're having to play these games without Mark McGwire, Ray Langford, and Fernando Peña. The hamstring injuries have kept them out. They did not play last night, yet they came back from a 4-0 deficit and won. J.D. Drew is the name. You have heard it before if you follow baseball. Well, last night, he delivered 2 home runs in that comeback win. A young man who looks like he is ready to finally make his mark here in St. Louis. He is not the only one, however. The St. Louis Cardinal team, Joe Morgan, unlike last year, has got more depth.
Well, that's definitely true. Last year, if McGwire was out, this was just an easy ball club to beat. Now they have Jim Edmonds. I think Jim Edmonds may prove to be the steal of the century. And Jim Edmonds, along with J.D. Drew, they're really swinging the bats well right now, and they're making up for the loss of Mark McGwire. And I'll tell you something about J.D. Drew. Last year, he struggled a lot with his attitude and everything else. This year, Tony La Russa tells me this guy is going to be a big star. He has the right attitude, and he's the right thing for this Cardinals team right now.
And Joe, in order to win, you got to have the studs pitching, too, and it looks like St. Louis has one of those.
Well, they got Darryl Kile from Colorado. Let's take a look at Darryl Kile. Last 2 years, he lost 30 ball games there in Colorado. And now he's here, he's the stud. He's won 8 ball games so far this year. He is proving that it was the ballpark in Colorado that caused him all those problems, not Darryl Kile. He won 19 games in 97 for the Houston Astros. He's back on track. He is the horse that they needed here in St. Louis.
Kansas City is an exciting young team, a great outfield. Jermaine Dye, one of them.
Well, Jermaine Dye is a guy that everyone thought that they had gotten taken when the Kansas City Royals traded Jermaine Dye for Michael Tucker. Michael Tucker got off to a great start with Atlanta, so he got all the headlines. It's taken Jermaine Dye 2 years, but now he has proven to be the superstar that everybody thought he would be. He's also on a chance to win the second place in the outfield voting for the American League All-Star team. He is a guy that everyone thinks has all the tools in the world to be the next big superstar here in the American League.
Well, let's take a look at the lineup that we will see tonight for the Kansas City Royals as they come across state here. Johnny Damon will be leading it off. Jeff Rebele will work at second base. Sweeney at first is having a tremendous year with 58 RBIs. That is second most in the American League. Then you've got Dye, Beltran, and Randa. Randa with big offensive numbers. Zahn's doing the catching. Sanchez at short. And we'll see Miguel Batista making the start tonight for Kansas City. For the St. Louis Cardinals, this is the man we were talking about. You've got to have a big-time starter if you are going to win and head to postseason. This 31-year-old right-hander, Darryl Kile, right now is that person for the St. Louis Cardinals.
Gary, he's the guy that they know that if they get in a losing streak, he's going to give them a good outing, and that's what you need. As you say, if you're going to win a pennant, you have to have someone as a stopper. And not only that, I think Darryl Kyle's confidence is gaining confidence with every start. As I mentioned, he's lost 30 games in Colorado the last 2 years, and they were not sure which Darryl Kile was going to show up. But this one that has showed up for them is the one who won 19 ball games for Houston in 1997.
He is 8-3. Johnny Damian stands in. Third game of this three-game series is underway, and the pitch is a strike call. Kansas City opened up with a 7-4 win in the first game, and then the Cardinals came back with that 5-4 win last night. Damon gets the third baseman moved in, not bunting there, right into that sun out in left field. Drew backs up on it, hands the bead and puts it away. Damian is retired.
And let's take a look at the defense behind Kyle. Larry Sutton is over at first base. He's replacing Mark McGuire. Craig Paquette's over at third. He takes the place of Fernando Tatis. And this is exactly what you were talking about. They have some depth this year, and they're still able to put a good team on the field and win some ball games.
The sun's still bright here, and what was a beautiful day. Temperatures were around 80. You see the shadows have moved out to around second base. Center and left are still sun fields. And a hard-hit ground ball by Rebele to second base. Polanco makes the play, and that's the way Darryl Kile will work. He is a first-strike, first-out type pitcher. If you don't come up swinging, you're going to get behind in the count.
And the great thing about him as far as his defense is concerned is he likes to work quickly. And that's important. You keep your guys on their toes.
What a difference for Darryl Kile from last year. He had the highest ERA in the National League last year in Colorado, where he gave up a ton of home runs, almost pitched scared because he worked behind hitters all the time, and his strikeout walk ratio was 1-1.
And it's 3-1 this year. So that shows you a big difference right there.
Huge difference for him.
And most pitching coaches will tell you you want at least 2 strikeouts for every base on balls you issue, and he is at 3-1.
Here is Mike Sweeney. What a story he's writing. Goes after the first pitch and fouls it off. Sweeney, everyone you talk to about this man says this is real. This guy is an outstanding hitter. He showed it last year. He is showing it again this year. He says power. He'll go to all fields. He has hit virtually every pitcher he's come up against in every kind of pitch. He is fourth in the league in average in the American League coming into today's play. Kyle's pitch to him is inside. Evens the count up at 1-1.
And the thing you like about him is that he has a very good understanding of their strike zone. He understands the batter's box, so to speak. He knows how to go the other way, knows when to pull the ball, he knows when to go back through the middle. And like you said, last year you can sneak up on guys every once in a while, but this year they know he's a great hitter, and you can see what Kyle's trying to do to him. He's run 2 fastballs off the plate inside, trying to straighten him up and keep him honest. And they know that he'll go out over the plate if they go away.
Mighty tough thing to do, because Sweeney will not back off. He's gone 4-10 in this series against the Cardinals. And a broken bat base hit into center field. He shattered that with the barrel of the bat going all the way to the backstop and the handle sitting out in front of home plate. He'll take it. Another base hit.
Good hitters get those kinds of hits. But watch, Kyle was trying to go away. They went inside hard twice. See, trying to go out here. He throws it on the inside part of the plate, and he breaks his bat.
Joe, that's his 81st hit. Only Darren Erstad of Anaheim has more hits in the American League than Mike Sweeney. Imagine that. Kansas City can. There's the first hit off Kyle, and here's Jermaine Dye. Dye's got a five-game hit streak going, 4-for-8 against the Cardinals in the series. This middle of the order with Sweeney, Dye, Beltran, Randa, they can give any pitcher, including Darryl Kile, some problems.
And last night, they were able to at least keep him in the ballpark. He had hit home runs in four consecutive ball games before last night. They held him to a double last night.
Leads the club with 18 homers, had a career-high 27 home runs last year. He's among the top five in homers in the American League. Takes that one the other way and kind of an inside-out swing. Davis is over and puts it away. No runs, a base hit, and one left on. Kyle out of the inning, leaving Sweeney out. A little help from Eric Davis, who's just following. Having to sit and watch the hamstring problem, keeping him out. Hopes to be back on Saturday, probably. Saturday or Sunday, back in the Cardinals starting lineup. So he'll be a fan in tonight's game, and here's the starting lineup for the Cardinals. Lucido Polanco leads it off at second base. Edgar Renteria, Jim Evans batting in the Edmonton, that center field slot. 17 home runs, tied for six in the National League. Eric Davis will back clean up tonight. We'll tell you about Sutton, who came up yesterday. Then J.D. Duke, Craig Paquette, Eli Marrero, and Darryl Kile doing the pitching. This man has lost his last three starts, Miguel Batista.
And his earned run average in those three starts has been very high. He's won two ball games and he's lost four. He has a good fastball. And he's also a guy that has good stuff, but he's got to learn how to pitch. And if you take a look, there are 25 base on balls in 41 and a third innings. Not very good. And that only 18 strikeouts. We talked about Kyle being 3-1. His is just the opposite.
Yeah.
Almost 1-2.
Miguel Bautista set to go to work as the Cardinals comes up. Come to the plate with Lucido Polanco working at second base with Fernando Vena out of the game with a hamstring pull. Vena was out working today and felt good. He'll be back. They have a day off tomorrow. He'll be back on Friday in the starting lineup. At least if he has it his way. There he is doing a little strengthening drill on the wrist and arms over there. Great addition. Vena's been a base hit up the middle. 3 out of 6 in the series and a leadoff single for Polanco.
Yeah, let's take a look at the defense behind Batista. This is that good young outfield for the Kansas City Royals. Johnny Damon, Carlos Beltran, and Jermaine Dye. Three guys that are destined for a great future. Last year, Carlos Beltran was the rookie of the year. And Johnny Damon, he was the guy that played center field before Beltran came.
They have a very interesting quality outfield.
And like I said, they're an interesting team to watch, a fun team to watch.
Blanco on at first base, and a strike taken on the fastball to Edgar Renteria. Renteria, a three-game hit streak coming in. He's had a 3-for-7 series, and now a .271 batting average. Checking down to third with Jose Kendall, the third base coach, to see if anything's on here. Randa, the third baseman, very close to the line and even with a bag. Casey tries to lay a bunt down. Renteria is a pretty good bunter. Not that time. He fouls it back, and it's a two-strike count on Renteria.
I think the thing that surprised me about Renteria here in St. Louis, when he was with the Marlins and they won the championship, everything he did, he back through the middle, left center, right center. And now he started to pull the ball a little bit more. He's hit a few more home runs, like everyone else. He's had 8 home runs so far this year. I'm a little surprised because I thought he was going to hit well over 300, which he may still do. But he's hitting .271 with those 8 home runs, so he sacrificed a little bit of his average for more power.
Blanco at first, and Batista misses inside for a ball.
And you can see right there that Batista has a good fastball, a live fastball. That ball looked like it exploded right there and had good movement.
Control, 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 Joe.
Yeah.
He's got the pitch. Trying to get it in the strike zone can be a struggle for him. 1-2 delivery. Looks like somebody's got a spotlight on him. That sun coming through the portals here. And there are portals all the way around the top of this ballpark. Sun's coming through one of those, shining right on the mound.
And the difficult thing is that, I mean, it's not ideal, but right there, with the fact that the sun is on the mound, doesn't make it any more difficult.
Breaking ball and a 1-2 pitch to the gap in left center field. That's going to fall in. All the way to the wall. Polanco will come around to score. Renteria will stop at second base with the RBI double, his 22nd run batted in.
Well, this is a big outfield because he didn't drive that ball, but because it's such a huge outfield here in St. Louis, the ball, you know, they'll find some gaps out there. He basically just finds a gap with this. So he doesn't drive it. It's more of a fly ball, but it's in the gap. See how far Damon has to try to go to cover that distance. See, it doesn't even hit near the warning track, but it rolls all the way to the warning track. And there you see Polanco come around with the first run of the ball game.
So, a bad start for Bautista and a good start for the Cardinals. Edgar Renteria with the RBI on the two-bagger. That'll be his 12th double of the year. Now Jim Edmonds up. Edmonds after a fastball and way behind it, strike one. The Cardinals get to Bautista early. Joe said, what an addition. Maybe the steal of the year. 359, 17 homers, 41 RBIs. Edmonds among the leaders in lots of offensive categories in the National League, including the fifth-best average coming into today's play. Ian McGuire among the top 10 in home runs. And Bautista misses inside to him, 1-1.
There's been a lot of articles written about Jim Edmonds in New York, if you take a look at Mark McGuire. The reason those articles are written about him in New York is because the Yankees wanted him for left field, and they didn't pursue him hard enough, and now everyone's looking back saying, we should have done that.
Boy, what an addition. I mean, any lineup, he rockets that one to center field. Trent backing up on it, has it. Runner tagging. Beltran's throw will come into third base. Renteria's in. The base running. Renteria knew right where that ball was going to be and stayed right on the bag. Bagged up, made it to third. And with one down, that can be a big play to create another run.
Good job there by Edmonds to get it deep enough to move the runner. Over there is Tony La Russa, the manager of the Cardinals. This is his fifth year, and you see he's had some off years here. His first year here, they did very, very well, made the playoffs. Now they've actually struggled since then, and there was some speculation over the winter on whether, you know, he was going to be here much longer, but he signed a contract extension, so he will be around.
Here's Davis. Harry Davis goes after the first one, and a strike called. Cardinals in a pretty good run with Cincinnati right now in their division.
And interesting the way they're playing this. The infield is halfway, which is something I like. A lot of infield, they move them all the way in on the grass, and it cuts down completely on your range.
They'll go to the plate if they get a chance. That one fouled back late on a fastball again off Davis, and the count goes to two strikes on Eric Davis.
Well, Eric is a good fastball hitter, so it does tell me that it's a little difficult to see out there right now. Like I was starting to say, it doesn't make it any more difficult because the pitcher's in the sunlight, but the backdrop is in the sunlight, and the shadows are between the pitcher and the hitter. That's what makes it difficult.
38-year-old Eric Davis waiting, and Bautista up high.
Well, you can see here, you know, the shadows right here are the ones that make a difference because the sunlight is here, so him being in it doesn't change what you see out here.
Davis takes it outside. One of the reasons Bautista struggles, Joe, is the follow-through he has. It varies on almost every pitch. He bounces all over the place in his follow-through.
Well, your good starters, your veteran guys, they find a slot, as they call it, where they're at a release point that is the same. And obviously, the more you can, you know, find that spot and stay within that framework, the better off you're going to be.
29-year-old who was 8-7 last year at a .488 earned run average. That has almost gone up by two runs a game on Bautista. He's made the rounds with different clubs in the major leagues. Ground ball, base hit up the middle. Eric Davis delivers an RBI single. Renteria scores, and the Cardinals have a 2-0 lead.
Bautista had two strikes on Eric, and he tried to go upstairs, and Eric took it. Upstairs is where you try to go. He gets this ball down. You see the target's down there. He throws it down there, and it's much easier to hit the ball down there on the sinker rather than up above. Well, the ball goes right back through the middle, and he can't get his glove down in time. A lot of guys fall off to one side of the mound, but he stayed right there. He just couldn't get down in time.
2-0 lead. Bautista has given up two singles and a double to the first four hitters. And that one to center field. of Larry Sutton's bat will be hauled in by Beltran. And there are two down. You see the problem Kansas City has right away. They are 14th in pitching in the American League. 14th in the number of home runs surrendered. 14th in the walks given up. I mean, they are near the bottom of the pile in almost every pitching category. They are struggling for starters right now. Bautista really should be working out of the pen, which he's done only once. All his other appearances have been as a starter. And the throw over with Eric Davis at first base and two down. Here's the man we were talking about in the open, J.D. Drew. Picked up the two home runs in the ball game last night. 3-for-7 in this series. Cardinals came back from a 4-0 deficit to win last night's game. And Drew fights it off for strike one. Thought your comments that Tony La Russa made you, Joe, were interesting. Drew's taken some flack.
Right.
Past couple of years.
And a lot of it, I think, had to do with the fact that when he was holding out, you know, he made some comments that I know what I'm worth and et cetera. A lot of veterans were upset, and I think they should have been upset. But once he got here, you have to give him a chance to prove that all he's about is playing baseball. And over the winter, I mean, all those things have gone away. All the distractions, and then talking to Tony, he just said that he's a good kid, he wants to play, and he's learning to play, so he has a ways to go, but he's going to be a pretty good player.
He certainly has the tools. Everybody has known that who has seen him play. And getting the opportunity, J.D. Drew. Two strike count, two down, but he's been trying to get out of here with the runner at first base. Play the left-hander to pull. In the infield, pitch is taken down low, 1-2. J.D. Drew, College World Series, Florida State. That's big, a big World Series appearance with him. You're going to be seeing the College World Series here on ESPN starting on Friday and on ESPN2. 1-2 the count. Swung on and missed and held on to by Zahn. So Bautista gets the strikeout with two runs, three hits, a base runner left on, and the Cardinals lead it. Beltran, Ronda, and Zahn will be coming up as the Cardinals take the 2-0 lead in the first inning. So Darryl Kile with some runs to work with here. Kyle is 6-2 here in St. Louis. ERA of 4.25. 2-1 on the road. His ERA is 6.33 in road games. Carlos Beltran will lead it off and takes the pitch for a strike. Beltran has not had a hit in the series as the switch hitter has gone 0-for-8 against the Cardinals.
And Gary came into the series swinging the bat pretty well. Really raised his average because he got off to a very slow start this year, and he's raised his average and was continuing to rise, and he got here and he's taking the collar the last couple of days.
Hitting 390 right-handed and 225 left-handed. Three home runs total, two of them hit right and one left. And Kyle ahead on the count of ball and two strikes. Talking to some of the Kansas City folks about Beltran, it's kind of a disappointment so far this year. They are concerned about the effort. He's hitting 257. They think he's better than that. And swung on and missed. Got him. Beltran goes down for the 41st time on a strikeout. He leads the Royals in that department.
Well, I think they should be concerned because last year, I mean, he was rookie of the year. He had great numbers. And you see right here, this is a specialty of Darryl Kile, though, that great curveball. And that's a big breaking curveball. When he gets ahead of you, and he throws that pitch, you'll see a lot of hitters chase that with two strikes.
That's his number one pitch, huh, Joe?
Yes.
And it is one of the best overhand breaking balls left in the game today.
He's got that little hitch. Does that bother a hitter when it throws?
Yes, it does. You like for a pitcher to be fluid. You like to be able to, you know, gear your eyes to his rhythm and to know exactly when the ball's coming out of his hand. But he hesitates a little bit, and all of a sudden, here comes the ball. He kind of jumps at it.
0-2 count on Randa.
In slow motion, you may not be able to see the hesitation that Gary's talking about, but right about there. No, you can't see it in slow motion, but it's definitely a little hitch there.
It's kind of like he cocks it again right beside his ear before he lets it go. Randa's got a 9-game hit streak coming in. A breaking ball he buried out in front. Randa has been an enormous success this season. 5th in the league with a 3.41 average. 7 home runs, 38 RBIs. He's done a fine job in the field for this team at third base.
hand has bounced around among teams. Pittsburgh, Mets. That one drilled is down the line into the sun. Lost sight of it. Goes to the corner. Drew will track it down, and Randa goes into second base. A 10-game hit streak for Joe Randa as he picks up a double, the second hit off Kyle.
And you mentioned Randa moving around a little bit. I think it's because he doesn't hit with a lot of power, Gary, and he has been a third baseman. He's always been able to hit. He's had success hitting over 300. That's a hanging breaking ball there from Darryl, and he ripped it to right down the line. I mean, this is a good hitting. You see him check. He strided out and then kind of stopped his motion, momentum, so to speak, and then ripped it down the line.
Randa's a great story because he's a manager's kind of player. 30 years old. Every manager he's ever played for loves the guy. Greg Zahn. Zahn pops that one up. Left field. Drew, where is it? Found it. Settles under it and puts it away. Two down. Zahn retired.
Although a lot of the things in the game has changed, one of the things that I think will always be the same is that is, if you're a third baseman, a first baseman, a left fielder, right fielder, you're supposed to supply some power and some RBI numbers. Whereas, you know, if you're a guy like Randa who hits for 300 but doesn't drive in a lot of runs, doesn't hit for a lot of power, you're always wanted as a hitter, but a lot of people, you don't fit in a lot of people's lineups. So that's why he'll play well, but they still end up trading him. He's hit 300 for Pittsburgh, he hit well for Detroit, and he's hit well here for the Royals. In fact, the Giants have a guy like that, Bill Miller.
Yep.
Very similar type players. They're good players, they hustle, they play the game hard, but they're not much of a power threat.
Here's Sanchez. Takes the pitch inside. Ray Sanchez, 227. Shortstop. He's faced Kyle more than any other batter in this Kansas City lineup. As Sanchez moved around the majors, he caught up with Kyle on a number of occasions and is 3-for-20. Against the Cardinals' 31-year-old right-hander. Only one error committed by Sanchez this year, short. That's why they'll go with that 227 average in the lineup. He's got some bats. Keep that good glove in there in the middle of the infield. Donnie Musick, fourth season. Royals manager. Hard-nosed, old-time, old-fashioned, not old person. Baseball man right there.
And he just signed an extension as well.
Yes, he did. Through the 2002 season, off the fist and foul back. They believe under the new owner, David Glass in Kansas City, that this is the man to build a young team, to let it grow, because he has demands as the old-time managers used to make, and is an outstanding teacher, but you're not going to slip ground with him. To play for him, you better be ready every day, or you'll hear it. And you talk to the Cardinals and other teams that play against Kansas City. Great breaking ball. They always say they come to play. Sanchez called out with that curveball we were talking about. Kyle's got two Ks. No runs. Base runner stranded in second. Cardinals looking for their 33rd win of the season. Have the 2-0 lead. That College World Series we were talking about from Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha, Nebraska. It all starts on Friday. Game 1, 3 o'clock Eastern. San Jose State and Clemson. Game 2, 7 o'clock Eastern. Louisiana Lafayette against Stanford. The College World Series coming your way Friday. There you see the matchups, Joe, for the College World Series. That one is hit to right field and deep. Down the line into the shadows at the wall. And hauled in. Guy went back on Paquette's far fly ball. Just stayed with it and caught it right at the wall.
Nice play by Jermaine Dye. He looked like he had it all the way, but he was quickly running out of room down there. Paquette a little late on, looks like a fly ball, but it just keeps going. And Dye, like I say, he had it under control most of the way, but he was closing in very quickly on the wall, and that was his only concern out there. Nice running catch. And not only that, he used two hands.
Not bad. Don't see that very often.
Not too often. All the young kids should use two hands.
Johnny Muser, fundamentals.
Yeah, good point.
He fires those kinds of things. 26-year-old Eli Marrero up. Catcher fouls it back, 1-1.
Young kids should always learn the game fundamentally correctly the first time.
You can always add your own little twist as you get good at these things, but the proper way to learn is its proper fundamentals.
The game a lot easier to play than learn the fundamentals. Two ball, one strike count on Marrero. One down, nobody on here in the second inning. St. Louis Cardinals lineup. Offensively loaded. Hit in the air to left field towards the corner. Johnny Damon over, and he makes the catch. Had it in the glove. It popped out. He caught it in his bare hand. Two fine plays in the outfield, and he was battling the sun.
Well, we talked about how good this outfield is for the Kansas City Royals, and this is another fine play. I mean, he banged the wall. I thought it was going to jar it loose, but he's able to hold on to it. Like I said, watch, he'll make contact just before he hits the wall. It pops out. Now he catches it, hits the wall, and holds on with his bare hand. Nice play. But I'm sure, like you say, that the sun, he was battling the sun, and you see, knocked his shades off.
Shades, hat, underside.
Well, he's okay. He's laughing about it.
Taking a little 1-4 from Beltran in center field. They know they're going to see that on the highlight reel later. Here's Darryl Kile, broken bat bloop into right field, and that's going to fall in for a base hit. Kile, who was 1-for-26 this year at the plate, delivers his second hit. Comes with two down here in the second inning. And there again, the College World Series. There's the lineup. Friday, two games we were talking about. Saturday, Southern Cal, Florida State, and also Saturday at 7 Eastern, Texas and LSU. Great matchup to Omaha. We wish all of them well. J.D. Drew, Florida State, once had three home runs in a ball game in a College World Series game. Rebel A played at LSU, and they're back in again.
How about that? Three California teams in there as well. San Jose State, USC, and Stanford.
Does that surprise you?
Yes.
Yeah? Baseball's kind of big out there, wouldn't you say?
Yes, but still, you know, three teams from California is pretty good.
Darn good. Remember one team, Carolina, got knocked out. Boy, that's a heartbreaker after the great year they had.
That's what's difficult about playoffs.
Yeah.
You know, and it happens in the major leagues, too. As they say, the best team doesn't always win, but the team that's playing the best at the time does.
That one is, again, to right, and that's going to get by Guy. All the way to the wall. Darryl Kile rounding third. Polanco going to third. He'll be held there. A 3-0 Cardinal lead on Jermaine Guy misplaying right.
Now, we've talked about the sun and how it's, you'll watch, he'll be running right between the tracks of those circles where the sun is hitting out there, and it's just very difficult to find the ball. See the, here, see how the, all that glare, he goes from the sunlight to the shadows, look at that. Then the sunlight, now he's in the shadows, and he just loses the ball, and there's nothing that you can really do about it. And the ball gets past him, good job of backing up by Beltran, or else we would have seen Polanco go all the way home.
It's an error all the way on Jermaine Dye, a three-base error. Just the second error he has committed this year.
And again, it's an error because he should have caught it in the big leagues, but it's just tough out there at this time of day. Because you just cannot, he goes from the shadows into the light, into the shadows. The ball's just tough to pick up. I mean, he was right in this track right there. And that's, you see all the sunlight and the shadows he had to run through to catch it.
Polanco's at third. No RBI. Renteria has an RBI with a double. Fouls that one back. Joe, we talk so often about how the game of baseball will humble you in a second. Two outstanding defensive plays by Dye and Damon, and then in the same inning,
right,
one that goes right through the wickets for a three-base error.
Yeah, that's the nature of this game. I mean, it's a very interesting game in that you can make a great play.
And there's another RBI for Renteria. A base hit. Polanco scores. So he's got a double and a single and two RBIs and two at-bats, and the Cardinals have a 4-0 lead.
And that's the Edgar Renteria I was talking about earlier. That's the way he always hit when he played for the Florida Marlins. Right center, left center.
And watch, he'll go the other way. Pitches down and in, and he just fights it off the other way. He inside outs it, and he rips a line drive in the right center field. But that's the way he hit before. Stayed pretty much in the middle of the diamond.
All of this is coming with two down. And Darryl Kile, the opposing pitcher, kicked it off with a single. Yel Bautista will not forget that. Runner goes, swung on and missed. Throw by Zahn off the mark. Stolen base for Edgar Renteria. Zahn has thrown out just 3 of 19 this year. And Edgar Renteria had a big jump.
Well, he never stopped. Bautista didn't stop him. He was on the move, and his momentum was going towards second base, and that's what you try to do as a base dealer. Never stop. Get your momentum moving before the pitcher actually delivers the ball.
9 out of 13 in stolen bases for him, and Tony Muser just has his head down right now as the Cardinals have jumped out to a 4-0 lead, 4 runs, 5 hits. And this inning, it'll all be how many ever there are, unearned runs. This inning should have been over on the scoring on that error to Dye, and he caught that ball of Polanco. Jim Edmonds now, the RBI chance, takes it outside, 2-1. For Edmonds this season, .283 with runners in scoring position on a Cardinal team that came into this game hitting .240 with runners in scoring position. Not a particularly good number. 2-1 to Edmonds, a chopper to short. Sanchez, and Edmonds is retired. However, 2 more runs are added. They are on earned. A couple of hits and 1 very big error with a runner left.
ESPN's Wednesday Night Baseball is brought to you by Hyundai. Every Hyundai is backed by America's best warranty with 10 years powertrain coverage. And by Keystone Light, America's never bitter beer.
And welcome back to St. Louis. Gary Thorne, Joe Morgan and our crew. Thanks for joining us. A beautiful day and a spectacular evening here in St. Louis. Game time temperature about 78 degrees. This couldn't be nicer. Miguel Bautista against Kyle. Bautista had a couple of at-bats. Interleague play, of course, in its fourth year. So these American League pitchers like Bautista get the hit when they are in the National League ballparks for interleague games.
Time flies. 4 years ago he started.
4 years. Does not seem that long ago.
No, it doesn't.
1-0 delivery. And that one is taken, 1-1.
And Bud Selig says it's here to stay.
Like the designated hitter?
Well, I hope not.
Me too, on both counts. 1-1 delivery.
I like interleague play a limited amount, you know, just so that some of the fans in the American League get to see the stars in the National League and vice versa. I like that portion of it. I don't like a lot of it because I think it'll take away from the World Series eventually.
Yeah, I agree.
If you do that.
Yep. Interesting, I saw Andy Bennis, who heads up the Cardinal Players Association. They had a meeting regarding the players are voting on a proposal to put in on restructure. I believe the clubs have already submitted one. And strike three call. Kyle gets the out. We'll catch up on that story after we check in with John Butchergrass. John!
Gary, Mitsubishi takes us to Montreal, not the Molson Center, but Olympic Stadium and Vladimir Guerrero. No batting gloves necessary. 18th homer of the year. The best home team in baseball, Montreal, going for their 23rd win a year at home.
Well, that's the reason right there.
Yeah.
Vladimir Guerrero and Jose Vitro. I mean, those two guys are good hitters.
Outstanding seasons for them. Players apparently are going to put forth a proposal, Joe, that would have just Houston move and even up the American League with equal number of teams, stay in the divisions the way they are, and not do what the league office and clubs are proposing, which is to have a couple of teams move, have it remain odd 16, 14 league teams and the one wild card in one league and none in the other. Players have a much simpler proposal they're going to put forward. 1-1 grounded foul outside of first base by Johnny Damon.
Well, I don't like the idea of one league having more teams than the other and one having a wild card and one without one. I like the idea of having both with wild cards or both without. I happen to like the wild card, so I'm a little strange situation here. I like the wild card. I like
a little bit of interleague play. I'm not real fond of all this realignment, but there are certain teams that have been in the league a long time, and they deserve to stay in the league. For instance, the Cincinnati Reds should never move. They're the oldest professional team. They've been in the National League all their life. And the New York Yankees, how can you move the Yankees, you know, from New York or from the American League? So I just, there are some teams I don't think should move. I don't mind the expansion teams moving because even though they've played there for a couple of years, they're not entrenched like right. The other teams would be.
I agree. I like the evenness of it. I think the player's proposal for simplicity purposes makes
right. Sense. Exactly.
There's that breaking ball again. What a curve. Kyle has now struck out four. Two down, two Ks in the third.
And this thing just starts to bite. Watch how high it starts. Way up there by his shoulders. And by the time he gets to the plate, Eli Marrero has to pick it out of the dirt. So great breaking ball there. And as you mentioned, not a lot of people throw that overhand curveball anymore. Mike Messina throws a knuckle curve, but it's a little different type of curveball, but it is over the top. But Darryl's is really a biter.
Rebele up, and he takes the strike. Rebele grounded out his first time up. Jeff Rebele, 2-4-9 now against the Cardinals. Cardinals leading at 4-0. Rebele takes the fastball up high. What a difference, Joe. Darryl Kile in Colorado last year, his home ERA was 7.44.
That's 7.5 runs a game almost.
At home.
That's like saying even to get a win, you got to score 8 runs just to get a win.
No wonder you pitch scared.
Yeah.
And he ended up giving up a lot of home runs on the season. 16 were hit by left-handers, 17 by right-handers. Strike three called. He struck the side out. So when he's not pitching scared or it's for a steal, that's what Darryl Kile looks like. St. Louis Cardinals leading it by a score of 4-0 in interleague play against Kansas City. And Eric Davis leads it off here against Miguel Bautista. Just turned 38 years old, Eric Davis, second year. For the Cardinals, down to third, Joe Randa, a pickup, and gets the out. We'll check in with John Butchergrass. John.
Gary, Mitsubishi texts us to Shea, another great hitter in the National League this year, Edgardo Alfonso, hitting .345, got 20 doubles, 11 of those, a home run. Next batter, Mike Piazza. Seven solo homer for Michael. Look how far this ball goes. Mets off to a good start. Calvin hit one for the Orioles, 2-1 New York.
You put one beyond that bullpen fence in New York, that was a smash. Piazza on his way to another All-Star game in Atlanta this year. Here's Larry Sutton. Larry Sutton moved into first base for a guy by the name of Mark McGwire last night. Called up from AAA and started and delivered the game-winning RBI with a sack fly in the seventh inning. He was on the roster at the start of the year but hit only .200 in 5 games and was sent down. Triple A, he was hitting .288. And you know, the guys were all over McGwire after the game, Sutton getting the game winner. Nice pick, Sanchez. And there are two down. Sunday night baseball. Speaking of, Piazza and the Mets, 8 o'clock Eastern, ESPN. Joe and John will be there as the Mets and the Yankees talking about interleague play at its best, a great rivalry. Mike Hampton scheduled to make the start. Yankees haven't announced the starter yet. Sunday night baseball, 8 o'clock Eastern. Right. Two down.
Always look forward to that inner city rivalry. It's always pretty good.
It's a little heated, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
And I'm talking about in the seats, not on the stands. not on the field. J.D. Drew. One battle that goes on the field, another one in the seats. Popped up. Catcher didn't see it.
Oh, makes the play! Zahn had no idea where the ball was, and it wasn't very high, and J.D. Drew walked away trying to fake him out. Zahn got it.
Fourth inning. Watch how the third inning ended for the Cardinals. J.D. Drew pops it up. Now watch the catcher, Zahn. See, right here, he's reaching back for another ball from the umpire, and the ball's up here someplace.
all of a sudden he looks up and finds it. I mean, that was an amazing play to be able to look up that late and find the ball and make a nice catch like that.
I've never seen that.
No, I haven't either. I mean, you usually can't find it. You can't find it. But he went up and found it and retired the hitter.
I think it was Joe Rando who directed him. Rando was coming in at third and was hollering at him. Here's Sweeney, who delivered a single, fourth best average in the league coming into today's play. Sweeney's kept it going.
Darryl Kile has quietly struck out four in a row.
Kyle without a walk. What a difference from last year that is. Ground ball to second base. Polanco. Sweeney's retired, one away in the fourth inning. This is the way Darryl Kile has been pitching this year to get to an 8-3 mark. Quick, effective, ahead of hitters, strikes, lots of ground ball outs.
And in the back of every hitter's mind is that great curveball that he has. So that helps his fastball.
Jermaine Dye coming up against Kyle. Kyle gets 74% of the leadoff batters in an inning. He's gotten all four so far in this game. Dye who flied out. How about this one, Joe? I saw this today and I had to check. I couldn't really believe it. Sweeney and Dye for Kansas City have more combined RBIs than McGuire and Edmonds.
That's one of those
20 more.
Did you know? Yeah, that's 20 more.
109 for Sweeney and Dye and 89 for McGuire and Edmonds.
That is amazing. I mean, especially when no one knows who they are, right?
Yeah, I couldn't believe it. I was just looking at the numbers, and when I added them up, I was like, there goes my math again. So I had Marty Aronoff add it up for me to make sure I was right. It was only off by two, but I had it on the right side.
You're in the right ballpark.
I'm in the right ballpark, yeah.
That is amazing.
1-2 delivery, and that just missed. Even Dye was looking back at the home plate umpire on that one.
Well, I said no one knows him, but actually, Jermaine Dye is second in the American League in voting for the outfielders behind Bernie Williams, so people do know who he is.
Taking a look. Travis Katzenmeier, the home plate umpire, calls it a strike.
Yeah,
that is six.
You can't continue to take that one just off the plate out there or just on the edge. But I tell you what, watch this. I mean, this is what you call pinpointing a fastball. Look at that. Throws it outside and it kind of moves back toward the outside edge.
How good is Kyle? That's four called strike threes, Joe.
And no argument from Dye. He wasn't real happy, but didn't really argue about it.
Beltran up. Switch hitter struck out his first time up, looking for his first hit in this series, as he is 0-9. Now you talk about these two teams. I mean, here are the Kansas City Royals, three games above 500. The St. Louis Cardinals are eight games above. $62 million is the payroll for the Cardinals, $23 for Kansas City. Not a lot of difference in the one-loss column right now for the money being spent.
Not as much as the difference between the payrolls, anyway.
I saw today that the $62 million is 11th in the league. Kansas City's $23 million is 28th in baseball. Great start. Put that up in the dirt. Nice hit. Sutton. Mark. Ooh. Cardinals up by a score of 4-0. A reminder, Stanley Cup playoff action on ABC. Coming your way tomorrow, Thursday, 8 o'clock Eastern, Game 5 from New Jersey. The Devils with a chance to capture the Stanley Cup. The Cup will be in the home of the Devils for tomorrow's game. If it goes on, Game 6 would be Saturday and Game 7 Monday, if necessary, all on ABC. Craig Paquette. Paquette flying out his first time up, bottom third of the order against Bautista. Breaking ball from Bautista, 1-1. Paquette, an 0-7 so far in this series, 255 on the year. Fernando Tatis remains out till after the All-Star break, so Paquette's playing third. You know the Cardinals want that big bat back in the lineup. Ray Lankford is one of the three suffering with a hamstring problem. Hopes to get back this weekend. Not starting tonight. Numbers for Lankford. as he, McGuire, and Fernando Vina all with hamstring problems for the Cardinals. One ball, two strike count. Langford came out Saturday. Vina and McGuire came out in the same ball game on Monday and just an inning apart.
And La Russa said it's been difficult because Vina said he's ready to play. And he was afraid to send him back out there. There's Langford. He was afraid to send him back out there for fear that a quick move, he might, you know, re-injure his leg.
Foul territory. There is room and hauled in. Nice play by Sweeney, the converted catcher. Grace is never going to be a word, neither Mark nor the descriptive term, to cover his defensive play.
But he does a good job of this. He leans over on the tarp and makes the catch. Loses his balance.
A couple of nice hits. Couple of nice foul ball catches we've seen. Yeah, he can hit.
Yeah.
Sweeney at first and Zahn, the catcher, making one in the last inning. Eli Marrero up there, and these two pitchers are on right now. Sanchez, another long throw, and he got him.
Not only that, Gary, that was a tough play. That ball hopped up, and he didn't even catch it cleanly. And he still made a strong throw to first base. And if you watch, he won't catch. You'll still be able to see this ball. That means he didn't catch it cleanly. Watch this. See right there? He bobbles it momentarily, but he grabs it and fires a strike to first base. That is a far more difficult play. See, that's a tough play when you do not catch it cleanly, and then you have to come up and fire a strike.
Nice play. Sanchez can play short.
You're right. Well, you said that he was in there for his defense, and he's proving it.
Yep. He's made only one error all year, Joe.
Well, he's made a couple of good plays tonight. I mean, that was a very difficult play right there. I mean, if he doesn't make it, it's a base hit. They wouldn't have scored that in error because it was a tough play.
32-year-old out of Puerto Rico, shortstop. We've had only one three-ball count the entire game combined, both pitchers.
Well, it's interesting. It seems like Bautista's gotten his feet on the ground, and he's been throwing the ball well since the first inning. He had a couple of an error behind him that hurt him in the second, but, I mean, he's throwing the ball well. And we talked about coming in at the beginning of he had walked 25 hitters coming in.
This is the guy he's going to get him out, but this is the last guy he retires because Darryl Kile, with two down in the second inning, delivered a single. That opened up two unearned runs. On the error on Polanco's ball by Dial that ended up being a triple to third base, three-base error. He got him that time. Bautista's got two Ks in the game, retires the side in order, and seven in a row retired by Miguel Bautista. Setting here in St. Louis, 4-0. Darryl Kyle's retired eight in a row, and for the Cardinals, he has become their number one starter, and more than that, according to Tony La Russa.
We had no idea that he would be as good talking about what he's learned, willing to keep learning. I mean, he's been a very good influence on our young guys like Rick Ankiel and spring training Chad Hutchinson or whoever it is. So he's gone about everything as professional as he possibly could. We didn't know that.
That's an interesting remark, that phrase, you know, being very professional. I think that's very important to Tony La Russa and how you carry yourself as well as, you know, is being a good player. And I think that's why he really likes Mark McGuire, and they've had such a good relationship all those years.
The start he's having here with that breaking ball again. He hasn't walked anybody. The six strikeouts you saw, trying to be 9-3 on the year. He is tied for second in wins in the National League, fifth in strikeouts starting the day. He's going to go after that with those curveballs he's throwing tonight.
Did you see that one? Can we see that one again? That was a big curveball. I mean, watch, this ball starts way up here and almost, look at that, see how high it is? I mean, that's a big breaking curveball right there.
0-2 delivered to Joe Randa, and he fouled the fastball back. Randa delivered a double, one of only two hits for Kansas City. Sweeney the other, a single. That's all they've had off Kyle so far in this game. Randa. 0-2 delivery to him. Strike three called. Seven strikeouts for Kyle.
I mean, he set him up perfectly there. He had him 0-2. He tried to get him to chase the fastball up and out of the zone. He fouled it, and then he busted him a fastball inside. So if you're Randa, you've got to be looking for that breaking ball. And that's
right there makes it tough. That's why in the back of his mind, that big breaking curveball was still there. So he sneaks a fastball by him on the inside corner.
Darryl Kile, 8 strikeouts, 5th inning. Zahn, who flied out. Kyle has had as many as 11 strikeouts this year. He did that against Florida. He had 10 against Milwaukee. His last start against Cleveland, he went 8 innings, giving up a run on 3 hits and struck out 9. Coming away with a win. Just missed inside. He is always there. I mean, all of these pitches, even the ones that aren't strikes, are that far off.
And I tell you what, his fastball is really alive tonight. I mean, there is some pop on there. There's a second stage like to his fastball, which is great. It's not just fast. There's a little extra zip of movement right at the end.
2-1 One of the positions Kansas City feels they must improve on, maybe even this year if they stay in the race, is the catching position. Zahn goes to center field with it. Shadows to the sunlight. It is hauled in. 2 down. We'll check in again with John Buchegrass. John.
Gary, Midas takes us to Atlanta. Kevin Millwood has problems in the first inning this year. Hitters hitting 353 in the first inning. Got no help from Andrew Jones' misjudgment. Toronto scores 5 runs in the first. Alex Gonzalez with that double. They lead 5-1 behind Clayton Andrews.
A couple of games this past week, the Atlanta Braves had some runs scored off them. Off the end of the bat of Sanchez and the play made by Polanco, and Kyle is rolling. That's 11 in a row retired by Darryl Kile. Well, you take a look at the World Championships that are up there for the St. Louis Cardinals. There is not one there from the series that was played against the Kansas City Royals. The I-70 series in 1985, in which the Kansas City Royals fell behind, losing 2 games at home. Controversial calls all over the place in that series. Whitey Herzog was skippering the Cardinals at that time. Andujar, who was known to be a bit inflammable in flame in that series, and Saberhagen came on to wrap it up. They came from behind to win that, and the World Championship went to Kansas City over the Cardinals in 85.
Yeah, that was difficult to swallow if you were a Cardinal fan or a Cardinal player, or just a baseball fan. It was hard for me, too. I watched it home because the calls that went against them really hurt them. Especially the one where Jack Clark, they say he didn't touch the bag at first. I mean, man.
That call has become infamous in World Series history. Lucido Polanco leading it off. Miguel Bautista misses outside. 2-1 Polanco's been on twice. An error and a single. Frank White, now a coach here, involved in that. The 8-time Gold Glove winner. You can ask him the stories about it. He's all smiles when he talks about it. That one misses outside, 3-1.
Kind of like the 1975 World Series. I'm all smiles when people talk about Ed Armbrister. Because Ed Armbrister, he never did interfere with Colin Pitts. I don't care what people say, but there are people in Boston that believes he did.
When you win, smile.
Oh, when you win, everything's cool.
Everything else is great. 3-1, up the middle, off the mound, and into center field. Polanco's on again. Leadoff man supposed to get on. He's been on all 3 times and has scored the previous 2.
Well, it's the first time that Bautista's really missed with a lot of pitches in a row and then had to come in with a fastball. And Polanco grounded it right back through the middle.
Good job he's done for the injured Fernando Tatis. He's hitting now over 360 in the starts he's made. This is his 18th start for Polanco. Here's Edgar Renteria. Renteria, 2 RBIs with a double and a single. Eric Davis has added an RBI in this game, and the other came on an error directly. There are 2 unearned runs on the board of the 4 for the Cardinals. Top 2 in the order have been on all 5 times up, Polanco and Renteria. And that ends the 7 in a row that had been retired by Bautista. 6 hits for the Cardinals, only 2 for Kansas City. Throw over, and Polanco back.
And you have to be aware of the runner at first because Edgar Renteria is a good hit-and-run guy, and Tony La Russa will hit-and-run quite often.
The Big hole between first and second with Sweeney holding the bag. And Urrea takes the breaking ball away. 2-0. Cardinals, the number one run-producing team in the National League, number one in home runs as well. They lead the majors with 103 home runs. Their ERA on the staff, though, is ninth. Bit of a problem there, but they've had some injured pitchers who are coming back. 2-0 count. That one fouled back.
And right there is why he has eight home runs. That was a 2-0 pitch, and he was not trying to hit a single to right field. Good smart hitting there. You get a hit in the count, you get your pitch, and you try to drive it. And that's exactly what he did there.
Edgar Renteria trying to add to those home run totals off Bautista. Cardinals have reached the 100 homer mark in the 52nd game. Only one team in Major League history did it earlier, the 99 Mariners. So the home run barrage continues. For the Cardinals, the problem's been it's all or nothing. They also are threatening to set a new franchise strikeout line. A lot of home runs, but a lot of K's. They lead the majors with 477 coming into this game. And Bautista's added two more to that. Blanco back to the bag with a 2-1 count on Renteria. One of the reasons, of course, for the home runs and some of the K's of that man, Martin McGuire. Jim Edmonds is second in the league in striking out.
And that's kind of strange to me because Edmonds always strikes out a lot, even when he's in the American League. But with his swing, he goes the other way a lot, which means that you wait a lot longer, and it surprises me that he does strike out that often.
Runner going, hit and run on. Sweeney makes the stop, tags the bag. Runner goes to second. So Renteria trying to drive it through that hole between first and second, hit it right at Sweeney as he was coming off the bag.
And you could tell two balls, one strike, perfect hit and run situation. See all this hole over here, and now watch where he hits it. I mean, this is unlucky if you're a hitter. I mean, he could have hit it any place over here. He gets a base hit, and he hits it to the one spot where there's a fielder. But his job was to get the ball in play and move the runner up, and he did that.
Now Jim Edmonds will have a chance with a runner in scoring position. Edmonds takes the first pitch inside. Edmonds has gone 0 for 2, 2 for 9 in the series. Sanchez will stay close behind Polanco at second base, trying to cut down on his lead. And Edmonds takes again on a 2-0 count. Bullpen has been active a couple of times for the Kansas City Royals, and they're going to keep it that way. Jason Riker's out there warming up. Bautista, probably the last inning that he'll pitch. He rarely goes deep, and they'll give the intentional walk with first base open.
Well, I think part of the reason they're doing this is he got behind the count 2-0. And they didn't want him to give him a fastball and maybe let him hit the ball out of the ballpark. So what they do is they walk him and get to the right-hander and try to get a ground ball for a double play.
McGuire leads the league in walks, 52. Edmonds is third now at 43. It's the second intentional pass he can give him. Eric Davis with a chance with Polanco at second. He kicked it off with a single. And Edmonds, who draws the intentional pass on at first. Bautista's given up the 4 runs, 2 earned on 6 hits. And the pitch is in the dirt for a ball. Good stop made by Zahn. One thing that has not hurt Bautista, the walks, but intentional is the first he's given up.
Slider in the dirt. Good job there. As you mentioned, Zahn gets his entire body in front of it and keeps it in front of him.
By Zahn has stayed in baseball, Joe. He's never been much of a hitter, but he is an outstanding defensive catcher. He's one of those who puts his body out there every game. Fundamentally very solid behind the plate, calling a game and defensive skills. Eric Davis, 2-on, 1-out, 1-0 count. Foul that one back off the fist, 1-1. Hitting only 229 with runners in scoring position for the veteran Eric Davis. Edmonds a much better number. Davis, of course, a right-handed hitter, while Edmonds is left. Kind of the reason for first base open.
Jim Edmonds. Davis, an RBI single in the first inning. We'll back out here. You're the pitching coach for the Kansas City Royals. You've got a lot to think about because this staff, one, does not have their number one starter, Rosado, healthy, and he hasn't pitched well this year anyway. Their bullpen's been a disaster. Brent Strom has done a lot of that deep breathing. And Tony just doesn't watch. This is the manager. This has been the problem for a good offensive defensive team. Foul back off the mask. I asked Tony Mizza before the game, I said, look, if you stay in this race as an organization, do you make some moves to try and get a couple of pitchers or at least one to help you in the short term by maybe giving up a little in the long term? He said, I can only speak for myself, but I hope not. That I think we're in the second tier of development. We got a ways to go. As I got Supan are going to be asked to come through instead. Go with what we've got. Maybe make one move, but not give up anything we're looking to use for our future. 1-2 delivery. Davis off the fists again. This time Sweeney over with no play.
Well, that's a great philosophy, Gary, but you're going to have to give up something to get something. And teams aren't going to give you something that they covet, which is starting pitching and a good starting pitcher. They're not going to give you a starting pitcher for just a minor league player or someone that, you know, may develop for them. If you're going to get a proven starter, you're going to have to give up a proven player in return.
That may be Johnny Damon, Joe.
Right.
Damon's in contract negotiations. His contract's got another year to go. He's asking for more money than Kansas City wants to pay. Johnny Damon may become available.
I think you always ask for more than they want to pay.
That's true. Having a dollar's more than they want to pay. Exactly. Ground ball towards short. Sanchez over to second. Revele the relay off the mark. Nice play by Sweeney to prevent that ball from going wide. Had he not, a run would have scored.
Well, a great play by Sanchez. That ball's deep in the hole, and watch how quickly he gets it to Revele in second base. Revele, not a great pivot man, but watch this. See how quickly he gets that ball there on target, and Revele would have had him, I guess, if he makes a good throw, but he's got a lot of pressure on him as Jim Edmonds comes down, and you see what he does. He comes right underneath him. Good job by Edmonds to try to break it up, but a great play by Sanchez to get that double play, potential double play started.
As he shined at shortstop in this game, and Sweeney made two fine plays, not first base. So first and third, two down, a 4-0 Cardinal lead. And here is Larry Sutton with another RBI chance and one strikeout on Sutton, who is 0-for-2 in this game. Sutton would love to add to it right here. Out of the ball game. 0-1. Fastball missed inside. One ball, one strike. Polanco's moved to third. He had a single to lead it off. And then Davis reaching on the field of choice at first. Larry Sutton, 30 years old. Major League Baseball with Kansas City before coming over to the Cardinals. Fouls that one off. He had 181 games with the Kansas City Royals at the Major League level, as well as about 5+ years in the minor league organization, and was signed as a free agent by the Cardinals. So Sutton loves getting a little revenge. How sweet was the game-winning RBI sack fly last night against his former team? To the count, two down, runners at first and third, and Sutton to short again. Sanchez will take it there himself, and that will do it. No run scored, one hit, two are left on. Cardinals cutting out Casey.
And it's 4-0 Cardinals. We go to the top of the sixth. Darryl Kile has been very sharp. Let's take a look at his 7 strikeouts so far in this ball game. A great curveball there got Carlos Beltran.
Then he goes another curveball. Just a perfect fastball, another beautiful curve, a sidearm breaking ball. Fastball knee high and away. This fastball knee high and inside. I mean, he's used the entire plate to get his seven strikeouts. And let's take a look at his ball strike ratio. There you go, 18 balls to 40 strikes. And I'm looking down there. His balls, his strikeouts to walk ratio is 7-0. He hasn't walked a hitter tonight.
A little better than that 1-1 we were talking about last year, wasn't it?
There's Dave Duncan, the pitching coach for the Cardinals. He's very pleased with what Darryl Kile has done so far tonight.
Makes it easy on a pitching coach when you're working the way Kyle is. Bautista's out of the game now, and Scott Pose is coming on as the pinch hitter for Kansas City. So Bautista works 5 innings, 4 runs, 2 earned, 6 hits. The only walk intentional and a couple of strikeouts.
He actually pitched pretty well, Gary. I mean,
yeah, he did.
He gave up the 2 runs in the first inning, but the other 2 were unearned. And he should have been out of the inning without any runs at all being scored. So, I mean, theoretically, he should be down 2-0 if, you know, I mean, he's only given up 2 runs. That's not bad.
Not bad. It's not good enough against Kyle, who's given up just 2 hits. And Lewis takes the pitch inside.
What's the old saying? He pitched just good enough to lose.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a lot of thought for a lot of pitchers who have losing records. And he only threw 77 pitches. He pitched well. I think they have to be pleased with what he did. Obviously, you want him to go out there and shut the opposition down, but very difficult.
And look at that. First walk given up by Kyle that goes to Pose. Let's check in with John Butchergrass. John?
Thanks, Gary. Midas takes us to Shea, Mets, and Orioles. Rematch of the 69 World Series. Reed against Erickson. 3 homers hit in this game already. Alfonso Piazza ripped him, but his defense by Jason Tyner, the Mets' number one pick in 98, throws out B.J. Serha. 2-2 as the Orioles bat in the pit.
Tyner called up as the Mets continue to look for a leadoff batter. Tyner was having a great AAA season. And a strike on the outside corner. Leadoff man is on for the first time for Kansas City. The walk is the first given up by Kyle. Johnny Damon's gone 0 for 2 as he has struck out and flied up.
The Mets had a leadoff guy, Ricky Henderson, but it didn't work out.
There's something there just didn't click.
You're right.
And then Ricky goes out and is doing a pretty darn good job.
That's Ricky.
Yeah, that's right. That is the response to virtually everything said about Ricky.
That's Ricky.
0-2 count on Johnny Damon. Lead at first base for Pose being held by Sutton. Pose, their leading pinch hitter, throwing that leadoff walk. And there's a base hit into left field. Played by Drew. So the Kansas City Royals, for the first time in this game, get an inning started with a chance. That came on an 0-2 pitch. And Damon's on with a base hit.
Well, he was trying to get a fastball up and get him to chase it. But because the shadows are gone now, you can pick the ball up a little better. And that high fastball is not as effective as it was before. See, that's a high fastball running away from him, actually. And a good job of hitting there by Damon.
Okay, the Cardinals come back now against Kyle. We got the middle of the order coming up for the Royals with Rebele 0 for 2, and then Sweeney hitting third. Looking for the bunt. He squares and drops it. Only plays at first. Kyle hustles over. It'll be a sacrifice for Rebele.
Am I missing something here?
Well, that's what I was wondering. Does he hit into a lot of double plays?
Well, it doesn't matter. I mean, you're in a situation where, you're in a situation of sacrifice. This is not a sacrifice situation. To me, you're down 4 runs, and you're on the road. You would think that you'd try to get back, you know, beginning to get back in the ballgame. You don't have to get them all back right at once, of course, but you're also in the sixth inning. You only have 12 outs to go, and you just gave away one of them. But,
yeah,
that's why we're broadcasters, not managers.
I was amazed, and the Cardinals were looking for a bunt.
Yeah.
And it clearly was the sacrifice that he was going for. Not a base hit, bounces away, good stop made by Marrero.
Sweeney's up. He singled in the first inning. One for two for Mike Sweeney. Two in scoring position and one out. The Kansas City trying to get back into the game. Sweeney is hitting .434 with runners in scoring position. It is the second best mark in the American League.
Well, let's say that's the reason then. Because he's hitting four plus with runners in scoring position, and you figure, well, if I bunt him over, I can get two runs right here.
Fly ball, he's going to get a run in on a sack fly, though. Pose will tag. Here's the throw by Edmonds. Not close, but closer than it would have been with a lot of center fielders. And they're on the board. It's 4-1 sack fly for Sweeney.
Edmonds, I thought, was going to throw to third base, but you see, comes up and he fires a strike. I mean, a beautiful throw because the ball could have been cut off. Well, as long as you keep the ball down where the cutoff man can cut it off, you can go ahead and throw to the plate, and he did so and just barely missed getting the runner at home plate. And there's Rebel A. He bunted. And you see Sweeney upset because he felt like he had a pitch to drive and he hit a fly ball instead.
Now, here's Dye with two down and a runner at second base, Damon. For Sweeney, it's his 59th RBI, second only to Edgar Martinez in the American League. And 110 combined RBIs now for Sweeney and Dye. Dye, who is seventh in the American League in runs batted in, he's got 51.
Well, maybe Tony Muser figures, well, my big guys are coming up. I'm going to make sure I stay out of double plays with everyone and give myself a chance for those two guys to pick up a couple of runs and get us back in the ballgame. We are in the sixth inning, and if you could pick up two, it's 4-2 going into the, you know, the last quarter, third of the game.
That's still surprising.
Yeah,
and that also means you're believing in your bullpen.
Yeah, but it's still surprising to me because I think even if your bullpen holds them, you still have to score runs.
And their bullpen hasn't helped you.
No, but you score runs. I mean, when you're down four runs, you know, it's just, I mean, just that's an unusual time to bunt, that's all. I'll just leave it at that.
One ball, two strike count, two away. Dye trying to keep it alive here and pick up an RBI himself with Johnny Damon out there waiting. Dye's hitting .282 with runners in scoring position this year. Chance to get out of it with just one run in if he can get him. Foul that one right off the end of the bat, a ball and two strikes.
Maybe one last thing on that. Maybe Rebel A missed the sign. Maybe that was the home run sign and thought it was a bunt sign.
When he got all the high fives when he got back to the dugout, it leads me to believe he didn't miss the sign.
Well, if they high five and he didn't miss the sign.
Yeah. You and I are just going to have to be non-believers in this situation, I guess. We can't make it otherwise. Okay, one ball, two strike count, two down. Oh, the big breaking ball. Took something off it. It is his eighth strikeout. Dye has gained twice, and it is now a 4-1 Cardinals lead.
Let's go to Montreal. Check out the Yankees and the Expos in the fifth. It's 2-2. Here's Bernie. Goes 5-0 on Carl Pavano, who came into the game 6-2 with a 3.05 ERA. But the Yanks having a good fifth inning. Bernie, a couple of RBIs there. Then Gino, the Bambino, deep to center. Williams on first. Took him all the way around to score. And the Mets, with a four-run fifth inning, have taken lead. A pitching change. Pavano is out, and the Yanks are winning.
The Expos had jumped out but couldn't stay there.
Yeah.
At home. Cardinals jumped out and they are there 4-1. Here's 23-year-old Dan Reichert out of Monterey, California, University of the Pacific. 8 games last year. Those are the numbers this year. And Reichert is in there with a strike to J.D. Drew. Drew, Paquette, Marrero do up for the Cardinals here in the sixth inning. 0 for 2. For Drew, chops at the second. Rebel A. One down. Only four have been left on by the Cardinals. Pitchers have pretty much controlled this game. First team to draw over a million this year, St. Louis Cardinals. Not surprising. One of the all-time great franchises and fan loyalty. They are now up to about 1.5 million. I take that back, 1.3 million. Averaging over 39.5 per game. Cardinal fans, they are loyal.
I remember Mark McGwire said that about Jim Edmonds. He said, you're coming to a real baseball town. You're going to love baseball here in St. Louis. And so far, he's been absolutely correct. It's interesting, remember McGwire played most of his career in the American League, and he came to the National League and he played here in St. Louis, and he said, this is the way baseball is supposed to be played. He said the National League has a rhythm to the game, whereas in the American League it was a little more disjointed, and I think a lot of that was because of the smaller ballparks, etc. He said the National League is a great place to play. You know, there is a rhythm to the game.
He wasn't sure when he first came if he was going to like
exactly.
it.
Exactly. Well, you know, when you change leagues, it's tough.
That one's going to be in the yard and center. Beltran is there, and he's got it. And there are two down here in the sixth inning. You never know what stories are going to pan out. Obviously, start of this year is about the Central Division and all of these home run hitters, and how many would they combine for? Well, they're hitting some home runs, but there are some other interesting numbers. McGwire missing, Sosa.
61 punch out.
216 average for Griffey. And Houston's in last place.
Yes, that's not what we expected. You know, the funny thing, I looked at Sosa's 61 strikeouts, and he's still hitting over 300. Reminds me of Richie Allen. You know, when Richie Allen put the ball in play, former Phillies player, he hit over 400 when he put the ball in play. When he made contact.
I think, Joe, Sammy Sosa is going to be traded before this year is over. I don't think they're going to pay him the money it's going to take to keep him. Base hit into center field. Marrero's on, 1-for-3, 2-out single here in the sixth inning.
You know, I always agree with you, but I'm trying hard to agree with you on this one, but I don't think I can. The reason I say so is because it's going to take them a while to build that ball club. And Sammy is the drawing card right now, and I'd be surprised if they do. But I understand your reasoning.
See, Bonds on top with 25 ahead of McGwire, and Finley is having a career year at homers with 20. Bonds is tearing it up. The new ballpark. Getting some recognition for himself, which he's always had, but at the top of the pile now. Here is Darryl Kile, who's working on the three-hitter. Having given up just one run, contributed a single in the second inning and scored. He's had a couple of hits now at 28 at-bats on the year. Runner at first base, and he swung at a bouncer. 1-1. The list being kept up to date, of course, permanent on the scoreboard. To where Mark McGwire stands, closing in on Mike Schmidt next on the list. Thought McGwire had a great comment. He's got a chance. The pace he's on, he continues to play, to catch the all-time leader, Hank Aaron. McGwire says if there's any labor dispute, though, that comes up 2 years from now, when there could be more baseball problems, he said, I will never play again. That if there's any labor dispute and the game is shut down by either side, it'll be the last time I ever play Major League Baseball.
And I'm glad to hear him make a statement. I'm not going to say whether he's right or wrong as far as that's concerned, but Mark McGwire is one of the leaders as far as this game is concerned. And, you know, what he says carries some weight. And I think he's telling both sides, you know, let's work this out. And I think that's great. He also had some comments about baseball opening the season in Japan, which I thought were great. You know, he's entitled to his opinion, and I think now he's starting to speak his opinion. And again, his opinion does carry some weight.
Indeed it does. One ball, two strike count on Kile. Breaking ball, got it. So Dan Reichert comes on, gets the strikeout. No runs, a base hit off it, and one left on with the Cardinals up. Rubber match. Trying to win this one. They are up 4-1. A reminder, some great games coming up for you. Wednesday baseball. The Red Sox and the Yankees. 1 o'clock on Wednesday. This will be subject to blackouts. It'll be seen on ESPN2 Wednesday. Red Sox-Yankees. Also on ESPN, the White Sox at Cleveland or Atlanta-Pittsburgh. On ESPN2, Arizona at L.A. or the Cardinals at San Diego. Big Wednesday coming up, starting in the afternoon and continuing well into the evening. Carlos Beltran will lead it off here. Darryl Kile worked the distance so far for the Cardinals with a walk and 8 strikeouts in the game. Beltran is grounded out and struck out.
I thought about something. Two Sundays ago, I did the game between the Boston Red Sox and the Yankees.
And?
Well, it was in Yankee Stadium. They're playing there again this quickly.
You're asking me? Yes, they are.
Well, you just read the script.
That's where they're playing.
Oh, you don't believe in what you read? Or?
Well, oftentimes that's the case. One ball, two strikeout. They're going to finish in New York before they go to Boston.
Yeah, that's what I mean. That's interesting.
You are always the insight you have. Yeah. Two ball, two strikeout. You caught that?
I caught
you
that.
You did.
Yeah, I caught that.
0 for 10 for Beltran in the series. Beltran started the season hitting third. Because of the poor start, he got moved down to seventh. And he's kind of worked his way back up. Tony Musser's kept moving him back towards the top of the lineup. And here he is in the number five spot. But the average is down to 255.
Well, it was at 266, I think, last week before he came here. And again, he has not been able to handle this Cardinal pitching staff so far in this series. 0 for 9 will hurt you this time of the year. Great fastball.
He's gone again. 9 strikeouts for Kyle. 2 in a row again. And that is twice he has gotten Beltran on K's.
Well, you can see the effect that great curveball had on him. He swung late on the curveball. Now he's looking for another one. And you can't look for a curveball and hit the fastball. So the fastball's right on you.
6 called third strikes. We've got the Kansas City players talking to themselves over there now. Joe Randa fouls that one off outside of first. He had a double in the second inning. There have only been 3 base runners left on by Kansas City and 2 of the 3 in scoring position. Their lone run came on that leadoff walk in the 6th. Opposed, the pinch hitter is scored on the sac fly by Sweeney.
You mentioned the 6 call strikes out of the 9 for Kyle. All of those were on the fastball. Just think about it. They're so worried about that curveball. He just sneaks the fastball by them for the 3rd call strike.
Broken bat to first base. Sutton will flip. Kyle will cover. He's got them all over the place, Joe, at the plate right now.
Well, they're looking for that breaking ball right there, looking for that great curveball, and he just gets him on the fist with a fastball. I mean, he is mixing his pitches very, very well. He's mixing, see the catcher sets up inside. He's going out there on that curveball, and all of a sudden it's a fastball in. Watch this. Watch his mouth. Oh, man, that hurts. Yeah, he just shattered that bat. But that's what you do. You go out looking for the curveball, and he runs the fastball in on you, and then you look for the fastball, he throws the curve.
Comes back with heat right there on Zahn, who's 0 for 2. Now, Randy Johnson has won 9 games with Arizona. Randy's going to get back currently tomorrow, or Friday, rather, in the starting rotation for them after missing a start. This could be the 9th win for Kyle if the Cardinals take it. Right now, the Kansas City hitters have not found a way to get to him.
Well, it's difficult for him to find a way tonight, Gary, because he has good control. He has 2 pitches working for him. The good curveball and the fastball, as I said earlier, looks like it's exploding right at the plate. He's got very good movement on the fastball. It looks like it's just taking off right at the plate. He's only given up the 3 base hits, 1 base on balls.
Great numbers. First time he's ever faced Kansas City. These hitters hope it'll be the last. Here's the breaking ball that missed inside, and he goes to a 3-1 count on Zahn. Herbalay's the man who bunted and set up the lone run with a sacrifice that we talked about. That's a manufactured run. That's all they've been able to get off it. This is just the second 3-ball count he's had. And a base hit into right field. Davis over to get it. So Zahn is on. That gets him out of an 0 for 9. He had lifetime off Kyle as he picks up the 2-out single in the 7th inning. They had a 2-out single in the 1st inning, the 1-out double in the 2nd.
sixth inning, they picked up the hit with nobody out that led to a run. And now a two-out single here. They've had only one extra base hit of the four they picked up. Sanchez, a sparkling day at short. Takes the breaking ball. He's 0 for 2 at the plate. The outfield of Kansas City has made only 8 errors combined, and Dye committed his second tonight, and right now it's looming as a big error, graded 2 unearned runs. He hopes these Royals can get back here, because that could be the difference in the game. 1-0 count to Sanchez. There's a breaking ball again in for a strike. Where did that straighten him up? Sanchez leaned way back on that one.
Thing is, this ball starts way up there. See how high it starts? Then all of a sudden, it just starts to bite. Comes straight down.
Putting on a show here tonight. Pitching exhibition. Fastball.
There it is.
That could fall in. It is a foul ball.
But you see how they're not getting a good swing at the fastball unless they're behind and ahead in the count. He threw him a curveball away. Now fastball explodes in on his hands again, just as he did with Randa. He shattered Rander's bat. Now watch this fastball tail right in. Look at that. Look at that swing. That's just a very defensive swing because you can't get to it.
Joe, if you're hitting against Kyle tonight, what do you do to give yourself a chance?
Well, you make sure that you hit the fastball early in the count.
Sit on a fastball.
Sit on the fastball early in the count, because if he throws your curveball, he's got to throw three in a row to get you out. But get the fastball and hit it early in the count, because once you get two strikes, you're kind of at his mercy.
Here's the 1-2 delivery, and there he goes. 10 strikeouts in the game, 2 more in this inning, and 7 of the 10 have been called third strikes. Cardinals 4-7-0, and the Royals 1-4-1. Gary Thorne, Joe Morgan, and our ESPN crew, Wednesday Night Baseball. Great to have you with us. Good game in interleague play. Rubber match between these two clubs, and the Cardinals on top. Seventh inning, Cardinal half of it. Placido Polanco at the top of the order. Has been on all three times to the plate, 2 singles. Reached on an error and has scored twice.
And the great thing, Polanco has done a great job. That, you know, they give Vina another day's rest.
That one hit in the air to center. Curving over his head and hauled in by Beltran. Polanco is one of the reasons Tony La Russa believes, look, we may be missing some key people, including McGuire. Lineup we put out there is still a good one.
If you get into it, it's just your excuse, because you're not going to make it anyway. And what we talk about is you're not going to win like last night. Some later on in August, September, we may say this is some of the best wins we get. There's nothing wrong with the lineup we start in this game. And if our pitcher, Darryl, goes well, and you only need to go to the bench once or twice, we got no excuses. If it's one of those games we got to go to the bench a lot, then we'll be short.
That's because he's short-handed. He only has 22 available players. And what he means is you can't pinch hit a lot. You can't pinch run. You can't do a lot of things. If they were behind and would have to pinch hit for Kyle or to pitch his spot 2 or 3 times, he would be in trouble. That's basically what he's saying.
Kyle's trying to take care of that, isn't he?
Yes, he has. He's not short at all, as you said. He doesn't run out of players at all.
Edgar Renteria in the off swing is going to get a base hit. He was fooled by the pitch but stayed with it. And Renteria's 3-for-4 with 2 singles and a double.
Well, good hitters do that. I mean, they stay there and they just try to put the bat on the ball if they're fooled. And watch, he'll be fooled on his pitch. See that? He just kind of throws the bat at the ball and he just flips it over the infield for a base hit. Over the head of Reveille and in front of Jermaine Dye.
Reichert on in his 23rd relief appearance, gives up that base hit. He surrendered a couple now. And that's 8 hits for the Cardinals. Renteria on at first base, 1 out. Here's Edmonds. 0-for-2 and an intentional pass. An intentional pass that worked in the 5th inning in the sense that they put him on hoping to get a couple of outs and leave him stranded, and that's the way it worked for Kansas City.
You watch Jim Edmonds, he's had an unusual hitting style in that he spreads way out and he doesn't stride a lot. And that tells you that he's very strong in his upper body, because you're not using your legs to help generate any bat speed. He's really hitting with the upper part of his body. See how far he spreads out? And he doesn't stride. He just kind of gathers himself and he swings with his upper body. In fact, that's the way Joe DiMaggio hit, basically with his upper body, not with his legs.
355 average for Edmonds. Takes the pitch inside, and a one ball, one strike count.
And what that does, he just rocks a little bit. What that does is it keeps him on the changeup off-speed pitches and gives him a little more time to watch the ball without a head movement, without his body moving. The detriment is that sometimes they can throw that fastball right by you because you're not getting your bat started quick enough by using your legs.
Sweeney holding on Renteria over at first base.
You very rarely see somebody spread out like that. Jeff Bagwell spreads out, and he doesn't stride very much either, but all Edmonds does is rock. Man, I mean, and Renteria had a great jump if he was thrown to the plate, huh? Renteria was just running off there and never did stop him. And that's what happened in the second inning when he stole second base. He never stopped. He just kept his momentum going and just took off for second base, and he was safely in before the throw.
9-for-13 in stolen bases for Renteria. That'll draw the attention of Reichert, who throws over again.
Yeah, but Reichert had him stopped, and that's all you want to do. If you stop him, you can go ahead and throw to the plate. He didn't, you know, he didn't stop him until he had already gotten two or three extra feet out there the last time.
Edmonds waiting at the plate with a one ball, one strike count. Well, Renteria gets the attention of the pitcher. 1-1 on Edmonds. And a pitch out, runner not going.
Well, I don't know if he was planning on stealing or not. He was going if he got a great jump, and the pitcher stopped him. I mean, guys that are on their own, they try to get a great jump. You don't necessarily pick a pitch to run on. You just try to get a great jump. And if you get that jump, you keep going.
And Reichert looking, Renteria edging off, not going. And the pitch is inside, and it's 3-1. Edmonds already has drawn one intentional pass. Edmonds has done it home and away, hitting .330 here, and the fifth best road average in the National League. He's hitting .391 in road games for the Cardinals.
Well, this is a perfect situation if you're Jim Edmonds. You say go because it'll open up a hole for you.
3-1 delivery to him, and way inside, gets away. It's ball four anyway. So down to second base goes Renteria, and down to first goes Edmonds with the first walk given up by Reichert.
Well, Reichert was trying to pitch Edmonds inside as Renteria was not going, and the ball gets away, and Renteria can go down to second base. Well, we have a quick moment here. Fernando Vigna wanted me to say hello to his mom, Olga, and his father, Andres, in Sacramento, California. And I say hello to him from Fernando Vigna.
And me too.
And one Gary says hello also.
When Fernando first came up, he was with the New York Mets.
Exactly.
And his mom and dad came to the ballpark, I think for the first game he played or the very first week. What a delightful mom and dad. Wonderful couple. Second base move was made by Rebele, and Reichert never looked back. Rebele, the second baseman, closed in behind Renteria. Eric Davis, an RBI single in the first inning, 1-for-3. He's hitting .305 on the year for the veteran. Davis with that waggle of the bat before he cuts. Behind on that one, 0-2.
And Eric has always had a problem laying off the high pitch, and he's not a good high fastball, a good hitter when the ball is upstairs. He's fought that his entire career, laying off of that high fastball.
And he still shoots that back to the strike zone in a hurry, doesn't he? Oh, he's got a whipsaw for a swing, and that one down and away gets him. So Reichert gets his second strikeout, two down.
That was a good job of pitching there by Reichert. He went upstairs, he got him to chase it, and now he throws that little slide piece down and away, and Gary can't get to it. This is just tough pitching because with two strikes, a lot of hitters will chase that breaking ball breaking down and away like that.
Santiago in the bullpen. I'm not sure about his health at the moment. He's just coming back tonight if he pitches.
Tony Muser wanted to get him into the ballgame tonight at some point. Said he's available. I want him to pitch. Larry Sutton is up. Two down. Runners at first and second, and a strike on the outside corner. So Reichert trying to work his way out of this and keep this a 4-1 ball game. Look at second base. Renteria jockeying with him out there. At the outside corner, quickly 0-2.
It's got good motion for that breaking ball. It looks like he kind of slings it a little bit. And that makes it hard to read the spin on the ball.
Joe, left-handers are hitting only 187 off him, and right-handers 281, and I think we see why on pitches he's thrown to the left-handers. He's kind of got that screwball effect down and away. Ball tails away from the left-handers. 0-2, a long look with a high set. That one to third base. Off the glove of Ronda Sanchez, has no play, and the bases are loaded.
I think that ball fooled Ronda, and he thought it was hit harder than it was. And his timing was off when he got there. Now watch this. Watch him go after the ball, Steve. Now he thinks it's hit harder than it really is, and it doesn't get there when he's in his dive, and by the time he reaches it, his rhythm is off.
They will give a base hit to Sutton off the glove of Ronda. And now the bases are loaded for Drew. Sacks full with two down. Reichert's pitch to him is inside, ball one.
Most of the time when an infielder leaves his feet, they will score a base hit.
Even when maybe he didn't have to. Three on, two away. Fastball in. High strike call, 1-1. First career grand slam on Brian Williams back on April 6th. 1-1 delivery to it. Off speed pitch. Good pitch by Reichert. 1-2.
And see, when Reichert slings the ball like that, it's hard again to pick up the spin on it. So he just kind of slings it, and it's a breaking ball down, up and in. Slider stays, goes under the hands.
1-2 count. Cardinals trying to bar the door here. They could get a big hit. They won't. That one away was a foul.
Man, I thought the ball hit him.
The home plate umpire, well, didn't single anything yet. Just a foul ball, I guess.
Well, I'm going to assume that was a foul ball. See where he touched the ball.
It went off his foot, didn't
it? It looked like it hit him in the foot. He didn't hit that ball. That ball, that bat is way above the trajectory of the ball.
1-2 count. You know what happened there, Joe? If he'd have started down to first base, I think they would have called it a hit batter.
But well, but he they can't call it a hit batter because he swung at it. He swung at it, remember?
Yeah, right,
they can't call it a hit batter.
Right.
They
could, but he never fouled it off either.
No, but they could call him out. Well, it could have been a whatever. They're going to end up a wild pitch, pass ball, yeah, whatever. But the ball, he definitely didn't touch that ball.
1-2 count.
Same pitch.
Same pitch, only this time it was caught and he swung on and missed it. Three strikeouts for Reichert, two in the inning, and the Cardinals leave the bases loaded, keeping the door open for Kansas City.
ESPN's Wednesday Night Baseball is brought to you by the United States Mint. The United States Mint reminds you that change happens. The new golden dollar, changing the face of money. And by Sam Adams. It's what's inside.
Thanks for being with us, everybody. Wednesday Night Baseball. I'm Joe Morgan. I'm Gary Thorne, and the Cardinals have a 4-1 lead as we go to the eighth inning. Darryl Kile has gone the distance. No starter against Kansas City has pitched a complete game against them this year. Kyle is trying to do that. Todd Dunwoody is coming on as the pinch hitter. Dunwoody against Kyle, and he fouls it back.
Dunwoody hitting in the number nine spot for Dan Reichert, the pitcher. The spot that started it out in the sixth inning when Pose was a pinch hitter and drew the walk and scored the only Kansas City run. Dunwoody will foul the fastball straight back, 0-2. Dunwoody kicks it off in a hurry. As he told you, Santiago is ready to pitch. He was warmed up in the bullpen. He'll just stay ready to come on in the bottom half of the eighth inning. Todd Dunwoody, 0-2 count. Dunwoody was called back from a rehab prior to the game on June 3. That's why he has had very little time. He had a severely sprained ankle in spring training, went on the DL, and had a right oblique muscle that he injured while he was rehabbing. He played 8 rehab games at AAA, and now he's back in the big club. Foul back. 2-strike count on Todd Dunwoody. Two count on Dunwoody. Johnny Damian, Reveille to follow. Then it would get him to the middle of the order. Kyle wants to stay away from him. Missed outside. Kyle has walked 1, struck out 10. His season high in K's. Team's hitting just .246 off him coming into this game, and the Royals have picked up only 4 hits. Breaking ball again fouled off by Dunwoody. Dunwoody hanging in here as a pinch hitter trying to kickstart this inning.
And if you're watching the pitch speeds, his curveball is a little slower than it was before. That's not all bad, but that means it's not going to snap quite as sharply as it did before. Still has a big break to it, though.
Kyle does not have a complete game this year. 1-2 breaking ball, chopped to second base. Blanco.
We talked about the fact that even getting a lot of called third strikes, and that's because they're looking for the curveball. And there's the first one for a called strike. The rest of them will be fastballs. Look at this. Two curveballs and all fastballs on the third called strikes. And they get him looking for the fastball, breaking ball, I'm sorry, and then he throws them a fastball. So he has set them up perfectly since the first couple of innings. The last 4 or 5 of those call strikes have all been fastballs.
Looking for his 9th win of the year and his 101st career win. He's 100 wins and 98 losses in his career. 1-0 count on Johnny Damian, the leadoff batter. Loops that one out to shallow left field. J.D. Drew easily under. 2 down.
Very rarely do you see a pitcher get a lot of called third strikes in this, you know, this day and age. A lot of pitchers say that they will not call hitters out because on close pitches they let them take them. So this is interesting in that Kyle has had a lot of called third strikes tonight.
7 out of the 10. That's a lot. He's got 2 down here. Reveille up, 0-for-2, and a sacrifice that set up the lone run in the 6th inning on Sweeney's sack fly. Kansas City all time 6-5 against the Cardinals in interleague play. The chopper to short. Renteria's got it. And a 1-2-3 inning for Kyle. Impressive. We go to the Cardinal half of the 8th in St. Louis with the home club on top by 3. Those are the folks Joe Morgan introduced me to before the game. Had some tickets available for tonight and nice hair.
Well, one is a St. Louis fan, the other is a Kansas City fan.
You're an honest man. Go to MajorLeagueBaseball.com for the most complete baseball coverage on the internet. Greg Paquette leads it off. And Santiago's on the mound, the third pitcher, Jose Santiago. Paquette, 0-for-3. 0-2 on the count.
You see the numbers for Santiago. Pretty good record. And the best part there is 9 bases on balls and 23 plus innings, and
Great fastball right there. It's been a strikeout game. Arquette goes down swinging. Want to remind you, SportsCenter's coming along at 11:30 Eastern on ESPN. Rich Eisen, Bill Pito standing by. Game one, Lakers-Pacers, Interleague Baseball Roundup, and the National Hockey League Final Update. SportsCenter. Good night. Eli Marrero. Marrero had a single his last time up, one for three. 25-year-old Jose Santiago, who's not pitched since the first of the month. Stiffness that set him down here. About him working on the side. Said he felt he was ready to go yesterday, and Tony said, Tony Muser said he'll be in today, and he is. Base hit. Bobbled by Damian. Gets it in time to hold him to a single. Two singles now for Marrero. Let's check in with John Buchegrass. John.
Gary, the Orioles are a miserable road team. 22 losses this year, most in the league, and their road woes continue in New York. Alfonso, who already homered earlier in the game, with a score tied 3-3 in the sixth, brings home Derek Bell with this triple. They're not done. 6-3, top of the seventh.
So the Mets in interleague play, going against the Orioles with the Yankees coming up. The struggle there. Darryl Kile is going to stay in the game as he'll take his turn at bat. He had a single and scored in the second inning. He has struck out twice since, with only one away here. Kansas City looking for the bunt. Tony La Russa is going to give him a chance for the complete game. Pulls back and a called strike, 0-1. Well, Darryl Kile certainly has earned the right to stay in and go for the complete game. The Cardinals have only two complete games. Garrett Stevenson has them both. Give Tony La Russa's bullpen a long rest, if he can do it, with a game off, day off tomorrow. Kile pulls it back again, 1-1.
Kyle's doing a good job. He's getting the bat out there first and then deciding whether it's in the strike zone or not.
There's a couple of sacrifice bunts on the year, along with two hits in 29 at-bats. Strikeouts for Bautista, three for Riker to work two innings, gave up no runs and three hits, and Santiago's added a strikeout for the first. Six strikeouts for the Kansas City pitchers this year. The Cardinals have averaged 8.3 strikeouts a game. That's a lot. One ball, one strike count. There goes the runner. Hitting, little hit and run on right there. Santiago will make the play over the first. Two down to second. Marrero will check in again with John Buchegrass. John.
Gary, bases loaded for Carlos Delgado. And he takes that hanging curveball the other way. The ball is flying out to left field in Atlanta tonight. Look at this. The Blue Jays 9-5 over the Braves.
Well, the Blue Jays can hit the long ball with some clubs, too.
But I have to agree with John. It looked like the ball was flying out of there, because if you hit it, it looked like a fly ball.
Yep.
And it flew right over the wall.
Boy, how many of those have we seen this year? Yeah. They are the number one home run hitting team in the American League. Toronto is, Anaheim second, and Cleveland third.
You made a great call there. You called that a little hit and run? That's exactly what it was.
It was very short.
A little, yeah.
Lucido Polanco gets the RBI chance. Well, La Russa just sent Marrero and then had Kyle swing away and just try and get it out there somewhere.
Right. He did.
Puts a runner in scoring position. Unfortunately for Kyle, he won't get credit for sacrifice. 0-1 delivery, a chopper to short, Sanchez. That'll do it. Kansas City will be coming up in the ninth against Darryl Kile, who's going to go for a complete game. With a 4-1 lead, out hitting the Royals 10-4. This copyrighted telecast is presented by authority the Office of the Commissioner of Baseball and may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form, and the accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without express written consent. Jerry Thorne and Joe Morgan. Mr. Kile is going for a complete game, helped out by an unusual inning. Two fine defensive plays were made in the outfield by Damian. Dye, and then Dye missed it.
And I really believe that the shadows, you see the sunlight there, really hurt Jermaine Dye because, I mean, he's a good outfielder. And that was just a difficult chance for him going in and out of the sunlight. And he finally lost it and he missed it.
That resulted in two unearned runs. He'll get a chance at revenge. Mike Sweeney will lead it off. It's Sweeney, Dye, and Beltran against Kyle. One walk, 10 strikeouts. Looking for his first complete game of the year. And a ground to second base in the first pitch. Polanco's got it, and there's one away. Sweeney's retired. That'll get you real close to a complete game to get that leadoff batter in the ninth.
Well, what he's done so far in this ballgame is he showed them that he has a great curveball and a good fastball. So now what you see is guys not wanting to get behind and be in the hole where you're in trouble with that big breaking curveball. So you try to get the first fastball you see and do something with it.
He's only thrown 101 pitches, Joe.
And that's the way that I expressed to you I would hit, too. And you see right there, Dye was sitting on a fastball ready to hammer it, too. So, and I think that's what you have to do. And when a guy has two good pitches going for him that particular night, you can't walk up there and just hit what you see all the time.
1-0 pitch, a chopper, base hit.
And that's the way to do it. I mean, they're sitting there waiting for a fastball and trying to do something with it. But in Darryl Kyle's case, he says, hey, I have a three-run lead. First guy hits a ground ball out. I'm going to try to get another ground ball. He did, but it was up the middle for a base hit. I mean, he's getting what he wants, sinker down and low, and he grounds it right back through the middle. But other than that, I mean, he could have hit a ground ball to the shortstop or at an infielder, and that's what Kyle was trying to do. Now you'll see him pitch a little differently because now he has a man on base, and he'll use his fastball trying to get that sinker to get the ground ball, and he'll also go back to the curveball a little bit.
So Dye's on with a single with one out and another base hit by Beltran in a hurry to left. Drew up with it. Now it gets interesting because the potential tying run will come to the plate. Ninth inning, back-to-back singles with one away by Dye and Beltran.
Well, you see right there, I mean, these guys are smart hitters. I mean, they finally said, hey, I'm not taking any more fastballs. I know that. And you haven't seen them do that because his curveball's so effective. They're taking a fastball and jumping on it. But if you're Dave Duncan, who's coming out, you look at the lineup, you say, well, Joe Randa's the hitter. He's not likely to hit the ball out of the ballpark. And you see Barris getting ready in the bullpen. But you can give him at least one more hitter because you figure Randa's not going to drive the ball out of the ballpark.
The bullpen is ready. Dave Duncan just came up for a quick word with Kyle. And now giving up six hits.
Well, if Joe Randa was a potential home run threat, I mean a big one, then you'd probably see them make a change right here. But because he's not, they figure if they can get him to get a ground ball someplace, they can get him out of the jam, and Kyle can get the game over with.
See if he can as he looks for the ground ball double play to end it. Randa's had a double and three at-bats. And outside for a ball. Randa's got a 10-game hit streak going. Dye has continued his to six. The single he's picked up. And Kyle falls behind on Randa. Now Randa is a red-hot hitter. 341, seven home runs on the year. Dye and Beltran on the base pass. And a grounder up the middle. Then it's a base hit. Dye will make the turn. Runner goes to third. And it's a 4-2 game with runners at first and third. As Randa gets the RBI base hit. His 39th run batted in.
Well, that shows you how, you know, baseball is really a game of inches. That ground ball was like a foot or so less from being a double play. Now watch where the ball ends up. It goes through right here. If Renteria catches it, that's a double play. But you see, he can't quite get there. And the ball goes through. He said, I got the ground ball. When he first had it hit, he thought he had the ground ball. And I'm a little surprised, too, because with a double play situation order, you usually play up the middle a little bit more. And Renteria was pretty much playing straight away.
Jeff Zahn, 1-for-3 with a single. As they leave Kyle on, runners at first and third. Kansas City has won 13 games in their last at-bat this year. They have won more one-run games than any other team in the American League. They're 11-6. They've got runners at first and third, one out in the ninth. Kyle again looking for the double play. Zahn, Renteria,
complete game win for Darryl Kile.
And that's a nice play there by both Kyle and Renteria. He's got all ground balls that inning, if you think about it. A couple of them found their way through, but he got the job done. Ground ball back to him. 1-6-3. That's the way the ball game ends. Now watch, the ground ball hit right back through the middle. Nice job by Kyle. Watch, he's in good fielding position. Right back through the middle. He gloves it. Finds Renteria. Leads him to the bag, and Renteria fires a strike to first base, and the ball game's over.
Darryl Kile is a 9-game winner. He joins Randy Johnson. Bautista the loser. He is 2-5, and the Cardinals take this series 2-1. Wow. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com, part of the Go Network, go.com. St. Louis Cardinals 4-10-0, the Royals 2-7-1. With Joe Morgan and all of our crew, I'm Gary Thorne. Thanks for joining us here in St. Louis, everybody. Cardinals win it 4-2. Lots of other baseball going on. Thank you back to John Buchagras. John?